So, there are two types of transposons or transposable elements. One class are the retrotransposons that perform a copy-paste mechanism using RNA as an intermediate by reverse transcriptase. The other class are class 2 transposable elements, which are also called DNA transposons. These jumping genes are particularly interesting as they serve as genetic tools that can be manipulated by scientists.
Yo, if they can jump, we should play ball sometime. I mean, like,
who let this chattering animal into the studio?
He just walked in, dude. We couldn't stop him.
Now, class 2 transposable elements, or DNA transposons, function via a cut-paste mechanism. And the Sleeping Beauty transposable elements are a type of these transposons. A DNA transposon contains at least a gene for transposase, in addition to other possible genes, and is able to bind to the 3' and 5' terminal inverted repeats. Once bound, the single end complex is formed. The ends are then brought together and both transposase monomers form a dimer, resulting in the paired end complex, an effective excision. Once excised, the transposon can then be inserted into the target, at which site the host will fill in the gaps.
Yo, did you say they exercise? That's actually kind of cool, man.
Excise? Is this in cut out? Not exercise? Excise?
Now, this is a rather exciting mechanism, as it is immediately apparent that gene insertion can occur on a biotechnological level. The question then becomes, are there limitations to these transposons? And in particular, limitations in their size, given they must at least carry genes for transposase. Isvac, Ivix, and Plasterk aim to answer this question in the study that we will be discussing today. They designed Sleeping Beauty DNA transposons with varying lengths of 2.2, 2.5, 3, 4, 5.8, 7.3, and 10.3 kilobases and inserted them into cells. They measured the transposition frequency relative to a baseline of length 2.2 kilobases. They found that for each 1 kilobase increase, there was about a 30% decrease in transposition frequency. They tested this by inserting two plasmids into a cell, one containing a transposon donor plasmid, and a second movement helper plasmid containing genes for the transposase, then determining the frequency of transposon movement.
You know, it sounds like those jumping genes are more like slumping genes, am I right?
Alright, let's just get this over with. This is a very interesting discovery, as transposons offer a potential mechanism for insertion of genes into a host genome. The reduction in transposition based on size poses a limitation on this possibility. However, a more recent solution has been proposed to use a sandwich vector, which is basically two complete transposons that are on either side of the gene that effectively increase the number of binding sites for transposase and improves efficiency of transposition. This enables the use of transposons to transport large genes, which is very exciting for biochemical research purposes. I'm done. This guy, he's ridiculous. Oh, is he done? Oh, thank God.
The snow glows white on the mountain tonight, not a footprint to be seen. A kingdom of isolation, and it looks like I'm the queen.